My name is Aincrow, and welcome back to Red Pill Game Reviews. When you mate futuristic technologies with historic settings, what do you get? What you get is a particularly odd kind of baby. A baby that is warm, moist, and has a very bad attitude. One of the ironclad titans of the steampunk genre in video gaming is the BioShock series. If you're about to jump into a BioShock game, expect a fantastical setting that somehow fails to completely beggar your belief. Expect beauty and wonderment that somehow fails to completely conceal the evils that lay at the core. And finally, expect a game that deals with weighty subject matter, yet it somehow fails to completely send your pretentious tripe meter into overdrive. That's all fine and dandy, but the meter BioShock Infinite is up against today is the Red Pill metric. Can Ken Levine's masterwork of imagination stand up to this test? If you don't mind a review absolutely full of spoilers, and I will most assuredly guarantee you that this particular video is full of them, then join me on a trip to Colombia. All right, let's get one fact that's very important out there straight away. I did play the original BioShock back in 2007, but I never finished it. Of what I did play, I can recall very little, so unfortunately I can't make many comparisons to it, and especially not to BioShock 2, which I've never played. That's okay though, because BioShock Infinite's connections to the previous two games aren't direct. The callbacks to previous games are mostly thematic and beneath the surface. Two of the original BioShock's greatest achievements were a compelling villain in Andrew Ryan and a failed utopian world that, despite its surreal location, somehow felt entirely plausible. It almost seemed as though an underwater city like Rapture probably could have existed in 1960 if a man with as much vision as Andrew Ryan had simply given it a shot. BioShock Infinite retains these two themes in the form of Zachary Comstock and his visionary airborne city of Columbia. Columbia is a thoroughly American city, representing the United States' high opinion of itself at the turn of the 19th century. The prophet Comstock constructed the floating city to demonstrate for all the world to see just how exceptional America really was. And of course, how exceptional he himself was. From a contemporary perspective, it's an odd feeling to see American symbology displayed so ostentatiously and without shame. Nowadays, we don't carve faces into the sides of mountains or put huge statues of the founding fathers on every street corner. No. Instead, now in America, we search under every toadstool for things to apologize for, and that's where our sense of righteousness comes from. Many human societies have engaged in the practice of ancestor worship, or maybe not full-on worship, but at least deep ancestor reverence, and being grateful for those who have come before them. Some modern Americans have taken to the practice of ancestor denouncement, cursing them for the things they've done, and proclaiming how much smarter, more moral, and generally better the living are than the dishonored dead. Well, Columbia is a city that we can scarcely fathom, as there is zero sense of a dreaded past that they are glad to be rid of. The past is glorified, and in many cases, beyond the point of reason, in statues, moving picture kiosks called kinetoscopes, in museums, and in many locations throughout the city. The patron saints, and I use that term more literally than you might otherwise expect, of Columbia are George Washington, Thomas Jefferson,
Father Jefferson, hear my prayer,
and Benjamin Franklin. They are often depicted with each holding an object representing their role in the rise of the United States. Washington carries a sword to symbolize the blood in which the nation was born. Jefferson with a scroll of unknown text, but most likely bearing some type of declaration. And Benjamin Franklin holds the key to your sister's heart. Okay, I'm joking. But if you're an American who doesn't know what the key means, just fucking... Okay, it's ingenuity, all right? And while we're on the topic of ingenuity, how on earth did someone figure out how to make a floating city a practical matter?
Hallelujah.
The answer is hot air and balloons. Lots of balloons. And lots of independently floating structures. The city is not one giant entity on a single floating plate. And rightly so. Think of the lack of structural or levitational redundancy should even a small, localized failure occur. The city is composed of huge areas, several city blocks in size, down to smaller plates with a few buildings or even a single building. Each plate has areas for docking with other plates, and many public areas have rotating shifts of buildings that will dock throughout the day. Columbia is a damn impressive feat of engineering, though obviously hot air balloons couldn't possibly be enough to get the job done. There is a missing piece to the puzzle, but I don't even want to broach that subject just yet, so we'll move on. So then, who run this town? A group of individuals known as the Founders, led by the prophet Zachary Comstock. That's who run it. This is a Bioshock game, so there is absolutely zero chance of these people being the benign rulers of an idyllic Eden. Propagandistic references to Columbia as being a new Eden, notwithstanding. The primary employer in the city is Fink Industries, headed by the ruthless businessman Jeremiah Fink. It is here that many of Columbia's wonders are constructed and produced, such as mechanical horses and magical human augmentations known as Vigors.
Those are no tall tales told behind the pool hall. No, sir, no, ma'am. Those are Vigors I'm talking about. Brought to you courtesy of Mr. Jeremiah Fink himself.
The city is home to a great many unique wonders, but the greatest of all is the Prophet Comstock himself. Let there be no doubt that the Prophet is a man of God. All of the statues and posters tell me so.
Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, God Almighty, you know, ruler of heaven and earth and every goddamn thing in between. You understand me now?
Come on. And so does random NPC chit-chat.
At least until the Prophet tells us more.
The Prophet will tell us what to do.
Comstock was granted the gift of prophecy by an archangel, and one of the visions he was given was of a grand city in the sky. This is how and why Columbia was built, and since 1893, she travels around the world, spreading the vision of America. Comstock guides Columbia with the authority of God and provides her citizens with moral teachings on all sorts of matters.
And when I came to Washington, there were few in Congress who saw my vision for Columbia. But it is the burden of the prophet to bring the wicked to righteousness. For what am I, if not a mirror to reflect the face of God?
The Comstock family is nearly as revered as the man himself. His deceased wife, the late Lady Comstock, is honored in museums, statues, and as the namesake of one of Columbia's most impressive zeppelins. His daughter, Elizabeth, is the key actor of Comstock's most important prophecy.
The seed of the prophet shall sit the throne and drown in flame the mountains of man.
Now, there don't appear to be strict laws preventing criticism of Comstock or the rest of the Founders.
I don't give a fuck what you think, bitch!
But why would anyone even feel the need to criticize one of the greatest men who has ever lived? The only possible reason is if they are a member of the Vox Populi, or at the very least a damned sympathizer. The Vox Populi are a blight on this town. Deigning to call themselves the voice of the people. I hear the voice of the people every day around here, and they all sing Comstock's praises. Just look at who the VP call their leader. Daisy Fitzroy. She is a black. And she is a woman. We, the real people of Columbia, the good people of Columbia, we know the proper place of a woman and of a black. And it's certainly not going around and causing trouble. Columbia's authority works hard every day to protect us from the Vox Populi, made up of blacks, Chinese, and the Irish. They are made up of thieves, killers of women, and layabouts. Though, I suppose I must apologize for repeating myself. They are unsatisfied with their lot in life on Columbia, but we have given them so much. Watch this excellent short presentation on how generous our society has been to the Irish, despite all of the troubles they've caused us. So, that's pretty much the setting of Bioshock Infinite, and I apologize for slipping into the voice of an average Colombian citizen, but this game is damn immersive. And I say that even though I played the entire game in the subpar display format of monoscopic. Pah! I might as well be a cyclops and only have one eye if I'm gonna play video games like this. If only I could have viewed this incredible game world in stereoscopic 3D. Well, that wasn't possible this time, but this experience of a city in the clouds is nevertheless fully amazing. Just the fact that it depicts a distinct era of America's past makes me enjoy this a lot, which was the same effect I got with Assassin's Creed 3. These types of settings are fairly rare in games, and I love it when developers put a lot of loving care into creating a virtual recreation. The wondrous 19th century American architecture is accompanied by somewhat less favorable blasts from the past. Columbia is portrayed as an overtly sexist and racist society, though to my disappointment, it's not shown to be homophobic. Homophobia! I like my ancestor desecration stories to show all three of the great modern crime think evils. They could have shown citizens so fearful of homosexuals, so steeped in their homophobia, that they'd rather just jump off the city to their deaths than answer a gay man's query for the time of day. Missed opportunities, Mr. Levine. I got to feel really good about myself for not being a racist or a sexist, but come on, man. Give me that hit of self-righteousness I so desperately need. Look at me. I'd give that guy the time of day. Let me feel that surge of indignation as I... Okay, these themes are heavy topics, so I want to discuss my views on how Bioshock Infinite portrays two-thirds of the great modern evils right now before we get into the crazy and confusing shit that is the foundation of the Bioshock Infinite storyline. Normally, I don't say, utilize, or value any of the three great modern crime think evil slur words, racist, sexist, or homophobia, as each is vague to the point of uselessness and usually hypocritically applied.
They put on all these terms, racist, sexist, homophobic, they all say, they're all the same thing. your synonyms for heretic.
But I will use the term racism in the context of the setting of Columbia. There is nothing vague or ill-defined about the racial hatred portrayed here. There's pretty much no sexual hatred portrayed. It's just that social norms expected women to lead traditional lives, as we should expect per the time period in which the game is set, though women could and did take jobs in Columbia's police force.
The shame lies to we who assembled outside the hall. Though we were not the ones who fell, I feel only envy for those who perished under his banner.
Other than the really weird doe-eyed character models for female civilians in this game, there's actually nothing of interest to note about the women of Columbia. The game's creators didn't put a whole lot of effort into depicting sexism, so let's talk now about the racism, which is a completely different story. I have played plenty of video games that have elements of hereditary groups having positive opinions of themselves and negative opinions of others. Now, the reason I say hereditary groups rather than races is because in most cases, these groups aren't subpopulations of the same species, such as like human races or dog breeds, but they are entirely different species. For some reason, it's sci-fi and fantasy video game convention to call these differing populations races. I imagine it must be a relic of Dungeons and Dragons terminology or something like that. Situations between species, whether the setting is futuristic or fantasy, makes up the bulk of racism in video games in my experience. These themes are present in fantasy game series I've played, such as The Elder Scrolls, Dragon Age, and Warcraft. It's pretty damn rare that I've played a sci-fi game that incorporates these ideas in a notable way. And the only ones I can think of right now are Mass Effect,
and you know that this game has problems,
and The Old Republic. I think I know why it's more common in fantasy fare, but that's a discussion for another time. So, animosity between species is well-trodden ground for video gaming, but what about between the human races as they exist in reality? There are plenty of insignificant parts in games in more realistic settings that have mild things like racial insults or general racial animosity. L.A. Noire is a game I've recently played that goes there.
Tell me why Mr. Kalu shot Mr. Gage.
Mr. Gage hates Jews. A lot of people do. It's not my fault if he has nice things.
Usually, games don't go much further than this. There's just enough racial tension to make whatever the setting of the game is feel more authentic. A game set in modern L.A. depicting underclass behavior would not be believable if it showed Hispanics and blacks getting along, because we all know that there's tension there. But BioShock Infinite takes things to a level I've never before seen in a video game. The mastermind of BioShock at Irrational Games is Ken Levine, and he dared to depict full-on systematic oppression of racial and ethnic minority groups on Columbia. In the first hours of the game, white people are shown enjoying comfortable leisure, while blacks are shown in positions of servitude.
Sorry, sir, but it'd be my pleasure to offer you a refreshment.
And they express muted deference to my character, who is a white man.
Oh, hello, sir. Don't you pay me no never mind. Just some foolishness, you know. Just monkey shines.
We'll talk about who Booker DeWitt is later on. At the very beginning of the game, Booker arrives on Columbia during its annual raffle and fair. And what we can see of this new Eden is clean and well-regulated. People are enjoying the fair. Singing quartets perform aboard airships. And there are some excellent fair games that involve shooting vox populi.
Hey you, handy with a rifle, looking to do your part for Columbia?
Those are my favorite ones.
No, aim for the box. Look at this fella go.
The advertisements selling cigarettes to children are a bit odd, but that's not something someone with an open mind couldn't forgive.
Never tire,
When Booker reaches the raffle, he's given his complimentary raffle ticket in the form of a baseball. Now, why would the ticket be a baseball? For efficiency, you see. The winner of Columbia's Fair and Raffle of 1912 gets a very special prize.
The winner is number 77!
Well, what do you know?
Number 77, come and claim your prize! First throw!
The opportunity to beam an illicit interracial couple in the head with your ticket.
Please, don't do this.
It was me! It was all me! Please! Please!
Please, what are you doing?
Come on! Are you gonna throw it? Or are you taking your coffee black these days?
The game gave me the choice of throwing the ball at the couple or at Jeremiah Fink. Well, you know me. My baseball wasn't going to find itself on any trajectory other than one that intercepts that couple. Hell, I'd take those baseballs from the people surrounding me, and I'd make sure that I could hit them both.
You've got to do something about that. Wait!
Well, turns out that the game was full of shit. And it stopped my character from doing anything before he could throw the ball. I don't know what the purpose of this false choice was, but I resent it.
The false choice is like the one the president laid out tonight. The choice isn't just...
There are a few more bogus choices in the game, and they are as pointless as far as I can tell.
Which one do you like more, this one or this?
I'm not sure what happens if you try to throw the ball at Fink instead of the couple, but I have to imagine that the police officer still grabs Booker's hand and stops him.
Stop him! Stop him!
Anyways, this is how BioShock Infinite introduces you to Columbia's attitudes on matters of race. The raffle is patronized by regular, everyday Colombian citizens, and they derive enjoyment from violently punishing potential miscegenators.
Mister! Wouldn't you like a ball?
Truly, the common man of this city is a scumbag! And this scene pretty much tells you all you need to know about how Ken Levine decided to portray racism in BioShock Infinite. Just like this game's cartoony, are exaggerated and larger-than-life art style, racism is shown in a similar manner that is exaggerated, cartoonish, and vividly vibrant. It all kind of fits together, actually, but Levine clearly had no intentions of dealing with racism in a mature or realistic manner. Now, maybe he thought that just the simple fact that he was showing white-on-black racism would make it, like, really powerful and mature in and of itself, regardless of how ridiculous the portrayal is. But what he did was take the pop-up book version of history that modern people have been taught, and he's translated it into video game form. What the average American, churned out of the public education system, knows about racism is here, but no more than that. BioShock Infinite's portrayal of racism is a cartoonish validation of the modern politically correct zeitgeist, equally cartoonish impression of how white Americans of the past viewed matters of race. These people are racist for no good reason, and all the reasons the game does give are easy for a modern person to proudly reject out of hand. And I think that's pretty much intentional, that all the reasons that are given in-game are things that your average person already knows the rebuttal to, essentially. The game is unfortunately just yet another entry in the canonical liturgy of ancestor desecration. There's no subtlety or depth here at all. Levine literally screams in your face, "Racists be around!"
No,
and he has entire sections that serve no purpose but to let you know, in case he had missed it, that racists be around! For me, the most ridiculous instance of this was in the Battleship Bay area, where Booker and his companion Elizabeth have to move through the city and avoid capture. This brings them through a bathroom for coloreds, clearly labeled because we wouldn't want you, you know, the dumbass player, to make the mistake of not figuring this shit out on your own. You've been taught the anti-racist script. You harbor prejudices about segregated bathrooms. Come on, admit it. But don't worry, Mr. Levine isn't going to challenge your comfy prejudices. Just look at it. The place is a complete disaster. This is the first time the game shows us a less than impeccably pristine area of Colombia. Shit's leaking everywhere, the lights don't work, on and on. Then later, after passing through an arcade area, you can see another set of bathrooms, this time clearly labeled as for whites. And these are clean and prim and proper, just as you'd expect, eh? Doesn't it feel good to have your expectations validated rather than be surprised? For some people, maybe, but me, I thought BioShock was about challenging such assumptions. But perhaps some things are too sacred to mess around with. Presumably, the same coloreds and Irish that are relegated to the broken bathrooms are the same ones who clean the whites' bathroom. So why wouldn't they be able to keep their own bathrooms in decent condition? Why can't they get some fucking light bulbs installed? These are questions that should not be asked.
As a boy, I had a dog named Bill. Like all dogs, Bill was a loyal friend. If we had not fed him, Bill would have been loyal. If we had struck him, Bill would have been loyal. Only when the colored man can make that claim will he take his place in society.
As I've said, this stuff is nearly all cartoonish. It's not meant to be taken seriously.
No animal is born free, except the white man. And it is our burden to care for the rest of creation.
That's Saturday morning cartoon villain shit, right? I mean, somebody with minimal knowledge of the rules of logic could pick apart the nonsense Comstock says here very easily. And it's a real shame that BioShock Infinite took this route. The original BioShock was praised for giving people interesting ideas to ponder and introduced many people to the ideas of objectivism. Got fucking helicopters coming.
Let it come over. Yep, go ahead, assholes.
BioShock Infinite could have been the same and made people think deeper about the motivations of people in the past with regards to racism, but they didn't do that. At all. It's completely in line with the prejudices the average person indoctrinated into political correctness already holds and does not break the mold even slightly. Why not have Comstock give a speech with arguments that somebody not drawn in crayon might actually believe? Have Comstock talk about crime rates, about loss of social cohesion. Have him talk about real things and not just baseless preaching. Make the player question his own motivations and beliefs about these issues. Inspire people to replace their anti-racist indoctrinations with legitimate arguments and principles against the idea of dominating others. These are some of the opportunities this game had, and that none of them were taken is a big disappointment of the utmost magnitude from a red pill perspective. Based on the original BioShock, I really thought BioShock Infinite was going to do something of value to our real-world thoughts and beliefs about these issues. But nope. It's more of the white people doing evil things theme that we've heard a billion times before. I'll give more ideas for interesting things that they could have done later on. As I see it, the main purpose of all this showcasing of racism in Colombia was to assist the game in appearing to be deep, heavy, and mature. Kind of like how games will put naked breasts in them to show you just how mature they are. These issues are related to the Vox Populi conflict that is a main element of the game's storyline, but it could have been done without these ostentatious displays to yell at the player that
wrists be around.
And I suppose I've put this off long enough. I've spoken plenty of the setting, excellently realized and interesting as it is, but there is much more to this game. The main storyline of BioShock Infinite is something I want to discuss, but it's going to be a frickin' nightmare to do so. The game's story spans time and space, so it's difficult to know for sure what the timeline is, or keep track of which universe is prime and which are alternates. Yeah, we're talking parallel universes up in this beat. I've reviewed my recorded footage, done my research, and come up with what I think is an accurate description of BioShock Infinite's time-traveling, dimension-hopping storyline. Wish me some goddamn luck. And feel free to speak up if you think I got something wrong. I've already introduced you to the primary antagonist, the Prophet Zachary Comstock. Now, let's talk about the two protagonists, Booker DeWitt and Elizabeth Comstock. Booker DeWitt is the player character. He's a military veteran turned private investigator. He was a member of the U.S. Army's 7th Cavalry Regiment at the infamous Battle of Wounded Knee in 1890. He was also a member of Pinkerton National Detective Agency, where it was his job to break worker strikes, sometimes violently if the need arose. His life's experiences have taken their mental toll, and Booker's in a bit of trouble with some gambling debts. In the year 1912, a mysterious man presents Booker with an unrefusable offer. Bring us the girl.
And wipe away the debt.
The girl is a mysterious young woman locked away in the renegade city of Columbia, which had seceded from the United States a decade earlier and was now lost to the world. The gentleman and a strange lady take Booker to an isolated lighthouse that hides at its summit a secret rocket ride up to Columbia. At this point, all he knows is that the girl is locked somewhere within an enormous tower.
Yeah, that's where they said I'd find her.
The way to Monument Island is secured, but it ain't like ADT is running things here. The tower proves to be a very odd place. It's really a laboratory run by the Columbia Science Authority. They have been closely monitoring Booker's mark for what seems like her entire life. We're able to view Elizabeth through some one-way observation glass.
That's her.
And now, it's the time for shit to get weird.
Whoa! Nothing to do with the job at hand.
Here's where we have to start wrapping our heads around the vagaries of quantum mechanics.
My name is DeWitt.
The principles of which I doubt I'd understand, even if they smacked me up on the side of my head. Quantum shenanigans are at the heart of everything in BioShock Infinite. It's not only the hot air balloons that keep Columbia aloft, but also quantum levitation. But don't call it that around the technology's inventor.
I had trapped the atom in mid-air. Colleagues called my Lutece field quantum levitation. But in fact, it was nothing of the sort. Magicians levitate. My atom simply failed to fall. If an atom could be suspended indefinitely, well, why not an apple? If an apple, why not a city?
This is Rosalind Lutece.
There's so many goddamn pronunciations.
This is Rosalind Lutece, the woman who made this modern marvel possible. Her work on quantum theory led to the construction of practical applications that are way more useful than anything we have today, even more than 100 years later.
She invented the technology that allows the city to float.
Giant balloons.
Quantum particles, suspended in space-time at a fixed height.
So, not giant balloons?
The timeline of the game is more than a bit puzzling, though. In the real world, the study of quantum mechanics was born when Max Planck defined the mighty lowercase h, Planck's constant. In the year 1899, he was able to solve an outstanding problem with black body radiation by presenting the idea that electromagnetic energy could only be emitted in chunks, rather than the more intuitive assumption that emission is fluid and continual. He called these discrete packets of energy quanta. Now, if you recall, Columbia took flight in 1893. In the timeline of BioShock Infinite, practical applications of quantum mechanics that do not exist even today had been invented and implemented by Lutèce before Mr. Planck had even founded quantum mechanics. Damn. Guess that's what we get for not allowing women to be scientists. What's more is that I'm almost certain that Rosalind Lutèce's name is a tribute to Rosalind Franklin, the woman that some claim did not receive proper recognition for her contributions to the discovery of DNA. Make no mistake, though, Rosalind Franklin is no Rosalind Lutèce. Miss Franklin was good at what she did, without a doubt, which was X-ray imaging, but she sometimes refused to make her taxpayer-funded work available to other scientists, and she seemed to have had little drive to make any great discoveries, unlike the men she helped make the first description of the blueprint of life. On the other hand, Rosalind Lutèce was a big dreamer, as you've already heard. She wasn't content to lift a mere apple. She wanted to lift an entire city into the clouds. That is her greatest accomplishment. Well, her greatest publicly known accomplishment, at any rate. Lutèce and Comstock had secretly collaborated to build a machine that takes advantage of the most intriguing possibility of quantum mechanics, that to this day remains unconfirmed. And of course, I'm speaking of observation of and interaction with parallel universes. At first, Lutèce was able to create the Lutèce field, a window into other worlds. I don't think the game ever explains how Lutèce met Comstock, but somehow, and at some point, he was made aware of the Lutèce field, which Comstock incorrectly interpreted as peering into prophecy. It was by seeing through these windows and seeing the so-called future that Father Comstock was able to build his reputation as the prophet.
Brother, what Comstock failed to understand is that our contraption is a window not into prophecy, but probability. But his money means the Lutèce field could become the Lutèce tear, a window between worlds. A window through which you and I might finally be together.
She seems to be addressing a brother. Yes, Madame Lutèce is referring to a man named Robert Lutèce, whom she was able to contact by an insane stroke of luck when examining a particular atom. They were able to communicate back and forth using this atom, though Rosalind hoped to eventually build a contraption that could allow them to meet. This brilliant inventor was able to create the Lutèce tear, allowing for venturing into other worlds. Her brother came through the rift and was introduced to Columbia. Except, he's not really her brother. Robert Lutèce is Rosalind Lutèce. They were just born as a different sex in each's respective universes. It was around the time of the tear's invention that she discovered why Comstock had been failing to produce an heir with his wife.
Comstock seems to have been made sterile by simple exposure to our contraption.
Comstock had a big problem. His greatest prophecy was that the seed of the prophet shall sit the throne and drown in flames the mountains of man. Well, as it turns out, his seed wasn't even potent enough to disturb a molehill.
Back much.
The solution was clear. He and Robert Lutice, they traveled to a parallel universe to find a newborn child and bring it back. They were able to successfully do so, but there was still a bit of a problem. The Lady Comstock was a very popular woman in Columbia, setting fashion trends and all the assorted ladylike things you might expect. Nobody had seen her pregnant, so. But there are benefits of being seen as a semi-divine man, as Comstock was. He was able to pass off the sudden appearance of the infant as being the result of a miraculous pregnancy in which Lady Comstock gave birth a mere 7 days after conception. A very likely and original tale. Comstock ensured that his wife was given legendary status and accolades for this, but she still wasn't having it. Lady Comstock suspected the worst. That the child's real mother was Lutice.
You are!
That's my mother.
I assure you, madam, my sexual interest in your dear prophet is non-existent. It's a lie. Come here, you little bastard! I want her out of my house!
In time, the child was discovered to have strange powers, and Comstock had her locked away in a tower on Monument Island. Which, given her suspicions, Lady Comstock was totally fine with.
My mother. She had me locked in that tower.
Still, though, 2 years later, Lady Comstock was threatening her husband's false narratives after seeing his terrible deeds.
If a man was ever unworthy of grace, who would be my husband?
To eliminate the threat, Comstock staged his wife's murder, blaming it on Daisy Fitzroy, which then led to a further crackdown on Comstock's enemies.
Anybody resisting? Goddamn my ass kissing.
All the while, the stolen child, Elizabeth, continued to grow up within the tower. Her power levels continued to rise as she aged, with a huge jump at the onset of monarchy. That's kind of weird, but hey. To deal with Elizabeth's incredible abilities, a siphon was constructed that would severely limit her ability to manipulate tears. And for 2 decades, she languished within that tower, her only companions a library and the mighty songbird. Booker succeeds in his task of exfiltrating Elizabeth from her prison, and they set their sights on escaping Columbia. Elizabeth is excited to travel to a place that she had read about and seen through her tears.
Why? What could be better than this?
Well, how about Paris?
Paris? I don't understand. How could we get there?
That's where that airship's going, but if you want to stay and dance, we can...
No, let's go! Come on, let's go! Right now!
Elizabeth has a peculiar deformity on one of her digits.
It's as much a mystery to me as anyone else. Maybe Songbird knows, but he's not talking.
I'm sorry.
What for? I get to wear this stylish thimble to cover up my hideous deformity. I hear they're all the rage in Paris.
Booker assures her that they will indeed go to Paris, though his only intention was to take her back to New York. Thereby bringing them the girl and wiping away the debt.
That's not Paris, that's New York.
How'd you know that?
Elizabeth accompanies Booker for nearly all of the game, and in contravention to most AI companions in video gaming, she is a pleasure to have around. She and Booker have lots of well voice-acted dialogue.
So, looks like they call you the false shepherd.
And you the lamb.
Let's not call each other that.
Suits me.
She wouldn't actively fight enemies with me, but she could open tears to give me advantages on the battlefield, or even throw me resources when I'm getting low on ammunition or salts, aka mana. She'll also toss money from time to time as well.
I found some money. Want it? Catch!
Nice.
Why she always be tossing me hunnits, you ask? I don't know what you heard about me, but can't you see? Then I'm a motherfucking B.I.M.B. Other than this, she generally stays out of the way. Generally, I say. A generalization is not an absolute. The fact that it's a generalization comes embedded with the understanding that circumstances contrary to the proposition can and do happen. Basically, what I'm trying to say is that she does get in the way. But generally, she doesn't. Elizabeth is by far my favorite female character that I've seen in a video game in a long time, if not all of all time. Yeah, I do think she is that great. She is undoubtedly of that familiar brand of character archetype known as the strong female lead that gaming has been criticized for having too few of. And if we're honest with ourselves, and, you know, Red Pill game reviews, usually these characters are insufferable thunder cunts. Generally, they are examples of poor feminine behavior, or they're basically written as if the intent was for it to be an annoying male character, but the otherwise male character is given a female avatar and voiced by a woman. Ken Levine got it dead on right when he conceived of and wrote Elizabeth, in my opinion.
Hello. Hey, knock it off! Stop it. Will you stop it?
She's perhaps a bit too worldly and confident upon venturing into the outside world for the first time in her life, but I can overlook that. The character is a nice mixture of vulnerability and helpful competence.
No, 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 Booker!
There's the age-old theme of the grizzled older man protecting an innocent young woman that touches a primal area of the human psyche. But she is, of course, a very powerful woman.
Is that?
It's a tear, something I can bring into this world.
She's eager to give Booker resources when he needs them, and she doesn't ask for a damn thing in return.
If you're interested, I spotted some supplies over there.
And of course, Elizabeth is a beautiful woman, you know, as is necessary to elicit the maximum amount of protective instincts from you, the player. But she is involved in absolutely no romances with anybody in the game. Talk about frickin' unusual. This keeps the focus on Elizabeth's role as the seed of the prophet, destined to rain fire upon the Sodom below, rather than distracting from that with some love interest nonsense. Plus, well, let's just say that that kind of relationship with Booker would make that interracial couple at the beginning of the game look like a match made in heaven. If you've beaten the game, you know what I mean, but if not, you'll know soon enough.
His bastard shall not be raised under this roof.
There's a very important sequence early in the game where the pair reach the grand airship, the First Lady. And I think I've shown you a little bit of this scene already. This is where Booker reveals that he was lying about taking her to Paris when he sets course for New York instead. Elizabeth is a clever one and recognizes the coordinates.
I owed money, and there's a fellow who... He offered to wipe away my debt in exchange for you. Come on.
And nobody likes to see a woman crying, so Booker, he goes over and he tries to console her.
Come on. Everything's gonna be okay. Will you just turn around and talk to me and we can...
Smack. If you were thinking that this is just another damsel in distress story, this fucks with that assumption. It appears that Ken Levine didn't want players to be of that mindset about Elizabeth, so he put in a section where Elizabeth runs from Booker. And this is where Daisy Fitzroy and her Vox Populi steal the First Lady and force Booker to get them some weapons if he wants the airship back.
You Fitzroy?
Nothing but.
Soon enough, Things get back on track, and Booker's role as Elizabeth's protector is restored.
Elizabeth, I've made an arrangement to get our airship back.
You can get us out of here.
Yes, I just need to supply enough weapons to arm an entire uprising.
So it's nice to see Bioshock Infinite make an effort to break out of this mold, even though it really still is basically a damsel in distress story. Just look at this example of promotional art. But bucking conventions is a red pill activity. I just wish the game had done so elsewhere, too. Elizabeth certainly bucks conventions for strong female lead characters, and I greatly approve. She's headstrong, determined, and capable, as any lead character should be.
Will you stop already?
I am not going with you!
Elizabeth, wait!
But everything about her is decidedly feminine. Irrational Games wisely cast Courtney Draper as Elizabeth, who has a pleasant, soft, and emotional voice. When Elizabeth is recaptured near the end of the game, she goes through several months of, shall we say, reorientation, and she recorded numerous voxophones.
Our minds are born festering with sin. Some are so blighted, they will never find redemption.
These voxophones were a brilliant tactic on part of the game's designers. Elizabeth's imprisonment and torture within this new laboratory have taken such a toll on her that she now speaks revelatory nonsense with the same tone and cadence of Father Comstock.
Comstock! What are you doing to her? Let her be!
Personally, it made me feel like I really wanted to find Elizabeth and rescue her from her fate at the hands of Comstock and his scientists. They were turning someone I liked into someone I knew that I wouldn't.
All I can do is watch as what I set into motion slides into its terminal stage. The seed of the prophet shall sit the throne and drown in flame the mountains of man. Say what you will about Comstock. Was a hell of a fortune teller.
The elderly Elizabeth gave Booker what his Elizabeth would need to prevent the terrible future where she leads Columbia in a war against the entire world.
It's for her. She'll know how to read it.
After Booker saves and reunites with Elizabeth, they are both focused on bringing down Comstock, and they board his mighty airship.
I may be the one who strikes you down, DeWitt. But you've always had a knack for self-destruction. Who's to say you won't beat me to the punch?
This is the climactic confrontation.
I need to do this.
Comstock has some interesting things to say about Elizabeth's mysteriously incomplete pinky finger, somehow linking it to Booker.
Ask him, child. Ask him what happened to your finger. Ask DeWitt.
Let go of me.
Ask him. Ask the false shepherd. Tell her. Tell her, false shepherd. Tell her the truth.
My hand.
Tell her.
Please
tell her
let
about
go.
Her finger.
That's it for Comstock. Mission accomplished, I guess.
You tell me, what did he mean about my finger?
Now they move to the bridge, hoping to commandeer the vessel so that Booker can fulfill his promise to take Elizabeth to Paris. Elizabeth still doesn't entirely understand the cryptic note from her future self, but when Vox Populi gunships fly in, thinking they're attacking the already deceased Comstock, she has a moment of sudden clarity.
What are you doing?
We have to sing to him!
She slams on a Comstock mechanical patriot to get at the music device within. She's able to reduce this thing to rubble using only a metal pipe and her admittedly diminutive upper body strength. It takes me a hell of a lot more to take down an automaton of this size. The Patriot heavy enemy type is really deadly, but also really cool too. They come in George Washington and Abraham Lincoln varieties, and they fuck up my day every time. These guys take a lot to smash to pieces. Hell, really every enemy does. You see, the problem that I have with Bioshock Infinite's first-person shooting is that it's not satisfying to shoot at enemies that just soak up the bullets. Their reactions to taking damage are minimal, and headshots are mere critical strikes. Critical strikes! Yes, this is an RPG-based combat system, minus the randomness. But it's just not as fun. If I want headshots to be one hit, one kill, as they should be in any first-person shooter, I have to use the sniper rifle.
What are you doing?
And shooting dudes with RPGs or some other type of explosive doesn't instantly vaporize the target either. This shit is lame. And what about that exploration? The original Bioshock had large areas to explore that had optional paths. Columbia is so beautiful, but there's shockingly little to explore off of the narrow path forward. Sure, I can search inside of every desk and find apples and assorted shit to eat and drink. And if I'm lucky, maybe I'll get some coins as well. Coins that I can use to purchase upgrades for my weapons and my vigors. Over the entire game, I didn't get nearly enough coins to purchase more than 3 or 4 vigor upgrades, and I managed to fully upgrade 2 weapons. And this game has a bunch of weapons. There's a Colombian Police Force set and a Vox Populi set, and each set's weapons basically mirrors the others. But you have to upgrade each specific weapon individually. And you can only carry 2 fucking weapons at a time. Bioshock allowed you to carry every weapon in the game at once. So, say you want to roll with the volley gun for a while. Pretty cool weapon, right? Well, you can buy as much ammo for it as you need at vendors at any time. And so that's no problem. But you can't get a fucking volley gun unless you happen to find one lying on the ground somewhere. And what are the chances that you're going to be able to find one when you want one? So your best bet is to pick 3 or maybe 4 weapons you want to upgrade and say fuck you to everything else. Because remember, you need upgrades to power your way through this bullet spongy, RPG-ish period rag of a game. This gameplay just sucks. Gameplay sucks. Gameplay sucks. Whoa. I've been talking about gameplay, haven't I? I'm not supposed to be doing that on RPGR.
If only one of you had the power to alter time and space.
That would be a blessing, wouldn't it?
Okay, here's what I'm gonna do. This just happened. I can't change it. It's the past, and what's done is done, and what will be done, and so forth. And I accept that. What I will do instead is, I'll have Elizabeth open up a tear right now. And what this tear is going to allow me to do is access a parallel universe. A universe in which I had the self-control to not rant about Bioshock Infinite's poor gameplay mechanics. A universe where the integrity of the Red Pill Review was not tarnished by nerd rage.
Don't worry, I will do you the courtesy of fast-forwarding to the point where the shit started going off the rails. My other self will finish you through the review, so I'll just sign off now, I guess. My name is Iron Crow, and if I survive to make another episode, I will see you all in the next installment of Red Pill Gamer! Arm stock, mechanical patriot, to get at the music device within.
It's not a word, Booker! It's a song!
By controlling Songbird, her former tormentor slash protector, Elizabeth and Booker are able to beat back the Vox Populi assault and fully destroy the Memorial Island Tower. And remember, the siphon was within. That siphon had held Elizabeth's powers in check for years, and it was now gone, so her full capabilities could be realized.
The Whistler! Elizabeth! The bird, Elizabeth! I lost control! He's coming!
No, he isn't.
Where is he? Where is he?
Yes. She has the power to open a tear out of BioShock Infinite right into BioShock 2007. That's some next level shit right there. Somehow, the removal of the siphon allows Elizabeth to fully understand what's going on.
Oh, come on. Yes, it's this way. See? Not stars. They're doors.
Doors to?
To everywhere. All that's left is the choosing.
She opens a tear to a pivotal moment in Booker's past, where a preacher offers Booker rebirth as a new man.
Are you ready to be born again?
I am.
Do you hate your sins?
I do.
Jesus! Wash this man clean.
Wait.
Father, make him
stop
born
it.
Again. Lord,
stop it.
What
no.
are you doing?
Do
it.
Get off me!
Son.
Get off!
Son!
You didn't go through with
you
it.
You think a dunk in the river's gonna change the things I've done? Let's get out of here.
Booker didn't take the man up on his offer, and he once again refuses. This next door, it leads back to Booker's office in the year 1893.
Bring us the girl and wipe away the debt.
Robert Lutece still wants the damn girl. This time, the girl is a little infant.
What is this? There was no baby. I remember. No, there was no baby, and if there was, I sure as hell wouldn't give it over to this guy.
Go ahead.
No.
You can wait as long as you want. Eventually, you'll give him what he wants.
That sounds like a metaphor for several sequences I've played in this game.
What choice do I have?
The debt's paid. Mr. Comstock washes you of all your sins.
Lutece gets what he wanted, but Booker had a change of heart.
Hey! Hey, the deal's off, you hear me?
Unstable.
The deal is off!
It's
give her back!
Hurry.
Give her back!
Fine, are you mad?
Comstock and the Luteces. And a tear. The hell is happening? Booker reaches for his daughter.
Give her back, you son of a bitch!
It's ready! Go!
But Comstock won't give her up. They struggle across the universal divide as Robert demands that the machine generating the tear be shut down. Rosalind finally gets it shut off, and Comstock gets the baby through. Though not entirely. Elizabeth's power to manipulate tears in the fabrics of universes was a result of the tip of her little pinky not making it through the portal.
Anna! Anna! No. No. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Anna, I'm sorry.
You shared this room with your regret for almost 20 years. Until one day, a man came to you and offered you a chance at redemption. A chance for us to be together.
Booker's memories had been mixed up. This was how he had really started his quest to get the girl from Columbia in 1912. The Lutesses had opened up a tear in Booker's now decrepit office. They charged him with saving Elizabeth from Columbia so that she doesn't go on to destroy the world.
So sorry, Anna.
You suppose he branded himself as some sort of penance?
Sort of.
Don't see the point. What's done is done. What's done will be done. I suppose the brand is his hair shirt, as he is ours.
Booker, wake up. This is where it started.
I sold you.
To your credit, you did try to weasel out of the deal.
This is all Comstock's fault. What if I went back, killed him before he did any of this?
The Booker we're playing as, the one journeying through Elizabeth's ocean of possibilities, has a plan for how to end it all.
Go back to when he was born, and I'll smother the son of a bitch in his crib.
Booker, are you sure this is what you want?
I have to. It's the only way to undo what I've done to you.
Booker DeWitt.
Huh? Here again. Don't you think this is an odd place to look for a young Comstock in his crib?
Of course it is. I remember. Wait.
Are you ready to leave behind all
you're
that
not...
has gone before? Wipe the
not...
slate clean.
Who are you?
You chose to walk away, but in other oceans? You didn't. You took the baptism.
A bunch of Elizabeths from various universes all converged on this one location in time and space. Some knew him as Booker DeWitt. Others knew him as Zachary Comstock. Regardless, both men must die.
Before you are reborn.
And what name should you take, my son?
He's Zachary Comstock. He's Booker DeWitt.
No. I'm both.
I do love me a good mind fuck story.
Twist ending of this story reminds me of the ending of another video game that freaked me out, but I won't spoil which game that was. So, now that you're refreshed on the story of BioShock Infinite, I can criticize this game's use of Everett's many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics. Now, I'm no quantum physicist, so I don't have scientific objections. I have story-based entertainment value objections. I think BioShock hugely missed an opportunity here. Several, in fact. The first time that Booker and Elizabeth shift between worlds is well into the campaign, and the player has a solid sense of the Prime Universe's Columbia.
It's another world, Booker. Another Columbia.
Something tells me one dead gunsmith ain't the only thing that's changed.
This would have been the perfect time to start really messing with the player. Change the character of Columbia significantly. That would be pretty cool. But no. All shifting into the different Columbia changed was that a man who could give Booker the weapons he needed was still alive. Lame-o. There are precious few other shifts that take place during the course of the game. But this first one pretty much sets the standard for what you can expect. The very next shift occurs soon after the first one. And in this universe, the Vox Populi already have the weapons that Daisy Fitzroy wanted. The Vox Populi are engaged in a full-on war with the Columbia Authority. And they're storming the castle, so to speak, of Fink Manufacturing, aiming to collect his scalp. Yes, literally. And Daisy Fitzroy succeeds in killing Mr. Jeremiah Fink. But this sick lady wants to kill his son, too. So, Elizabeth to the rescue.
It's the only way to be...
Elizabeth.
I guess it runs in the family.
Poor Elizabeth, having to get her hands bloody.
Elizabeth. Whoa, hey, easy.
The Vox Populi are enemies from this point forward until the end of the game.
The Vox are coming! We need to leave the dock!
We need to push off immediately!
Where are these people going?
Wherever the Vox Populi ain't.
That is cool, and I didn't expect it, given that they were fighting against what the game clearly wanted me to understand was over-the-top racial hatred. Because remember, racists be around.
You ain't a person of them. You're a tool.
BioShock Infinite has this great concept of parallel universes, but other than the Vox Populi becoming bad guys and the stuff that occurs in the main storyline, most of which is just backstory in the form of cutscenes, they don't really put the alternative universes idea to good use. They were able to work it into the combat mechanics by allowing Elizabeth to grant access to resources from other universes.
Do it!
All right!
But this is lackluster.
I don't like the looks of this!
The story features surprisingly few shifts to alternate universes, and I would have liked to see more shifts and many more differences among the worlds.
City at the bottom of the ocean. Ridiculous.
I have some ideas for your consideration. The developers were willing to turn the Vox Populi into bad guys, we know that. So why not take this a step further and have a parallel universe where Daisy Fitzroy is the leader of Columbia?
Comstock is the god of the white man, the rich man, the pitiless man. But if you believe in common folk, then join the Vox.
In this universe, Black Africans were the ones who colonized the Americas in the middle of the second millennium, and they brought white slaves over. By the time of Columbia, which had of course been built by a black woman, because, you know, something gotta stay the same, it was the black-run city leadership being mean to the white minority.
To keep you chasing that almighty silver eagle so you can buy everything they're selling to keep you down, brother.
Comstock is now a humble religious man. He's just trying to earn fair treatment for his people. He leads the Pax Vopuli. The city's appearance in this universe should be different too, though I'm not sure what it would look like. So that's an idea, but how about they take the opportunity to really fuck with people's minds and tear into an alternate universe in which the inferiority of the black, of the Chinaman, and of the Irishman are established, properly proven, scientific facts. Where it really would be cruel to allow the black man to live in Africa, constantly ill of body and perpetually ignorant. Where he is undoubtedly better off in the custody of the white man.
Fascinating.
But everybody made it work. There was no resentment, no oppression of one over the other, and certainly no hate.
Fascinating. But quite impossible.
It's a world unimaginable to the blue pill player. This is why they cling to impossible and counter-evolutionary beliefs about innate racial equality in all manners of importance, because the alternate reality I described is impossible in their view.
But that's impossible. That's what I was taught.
Well, this is an alternate universe, where the rules may be the same, or they may be different, who knows? What I do know is that it would be damn interesting.
Please, Spock, do me a favor, and don't say it's fascinating. No. But it is interesting.
But BioShock Infinite's use of parallel universes is not very interesting. Maybe next time. So, this has been an absurdly long and detailed look at BioShock Infinite. I know I've said I wanted to make shorter videos, but hey, I've just come to accept these videos are going to be the length that they are.
You down with that? You ain't down with that? Shut your goddamn ass up!
So, overall, what do I think of this game? Well, the way it deals with racism is pretty bad. Blue Pill City population Toontown. But it's so ridiculous and exaggerated that it kind of fits with the game's cartoony art style and overall larger-than-life kind of vibe. This is not supposed to be a realistic game. And when I internalize this fact, I can accept the game for what it is, and I don't lament as much what it is not. It is not a mature or thought-provoking depiction of racial enmity, some other commentator's impressions notwithstanding.
The way that it deals with racism, for instance, there's a lot of white supremacist stuff in this game. But the weird thing about it is that you would expect, you know, to be instantly abhorred by the notion that, oh, racism? You know, this is such an outdated ideal. But the way that it presents it is actually so mature and so smart. There are, worryingly enough, times when you end up finding yourself saying, huh, you know, he kind of has a point.
To give the vote to the white man and deny it to the yellow, the black, the red, is that not cruel? But is it not cruel to banish your children from a perfect garden? Or drown your flock under an ocean of water? Cruelty can be instructive. And what is Columbia, if not the schoolhouse of the Lord?
This is so bad and ridiculous that it instantly removes a red pill from the game, in my opinion. I mentioned L.A. Noir earlier in the review, which was like 5 hours ago, it seems. But that game deals with this stuff correctly, in my opinion. It portrays antiquated attitudes about race and sex in a believable fashion by showing these beliefs in a completely mundane manner.
White man supplies, black man buys.
It doesn't go out of its way to judge them from a modern perspective either, which would thereby break the immersion that depicting beliefs like these is supposed to achieve. It's just the way things were in 1947 Los Angeles. Contrast that to Columbia, which takes the funhouse or theme park approach to portraying racism and robber baron stereotypes.
Park's closing, everyone.
But the game does have things that can raise the interest of a red pill junkie. Please observe. Yes, indeed. BioShock Infinite does require you to kill virtual characters with human female art models and female voice actresses. These characters are in the distinct minority of enemies Booker has to kill, mind you. But BioShock Infinite is doing its part to engender virtual equality between the virtual characters that are virtualized representations of the two actual human sexes. I can't remember the last time I killed a black woman in a video game.
Don't kill me!
No, wait, I can't. This poor lady doesn't really count, though, because remember, for a game to earn that badge for no-killable human female enemies, of course it has to have humans that are killable, but they have to be enemies according to the game's design. Unnecessary murders of civilians don't count.
Like, who does that? Really?
BioShock Infinite does good work in closing the virtual characters as victims of mandatory violence at the hands of the player character's sex gap. Currently, video game developers are unjustly giving nearly all of that dubious honor to virtual male characters. No longer should any violent video game disrespect virtual women by denying them the opportunity to make futile attempts to stop player characters from achieving their goals. Let us show the world that female bodies vaporize into glorious plumes of ash, too. And female heads explode just as satisfyingly as male ones. Let us unite as one in getting more female avatars as goons and henchmen to be mowed down. And and virtual women can serve as ammo restocking units in this game. BioShock Infinite is an impressive game, and while it doesn't directly offend red pill sensibilities, it does chafe me indirectly by failing to use the alternate worlds theme as an excuse to do some really cool shit. And if the politically correct gaming police complain about something in the game, just say, hey, it was an alternate universe. BioShock is a series about expanding people's minds and making them consider possibilities they had never had before. So we stand by everything we've shown. Sadly, Irrational Games played it safe. For that, I will always look back on BioShock Infinite with a sense of regret and a longing for more. So when you hear me say all this, acknowledge that my disappointment is there and it exists, but please keep in mind that I thoroughly enjoyed this game despite its weak gameplay and middling red pill value. I kind of wanted to put some discussion of the gameplay into this review, but I held back. I didn't do it, because I need to keep with RPGR's goal of focusing on stories, ideas, and characters, not that nerdy shit like gameplay mechanics. The excellence of Elizabeth's character saves this game from receiving 2 red pills or less, and instead, I will give it 3. Not the highest possible red pill score, to be sure, but don't get fucking confused. BioShock Infinite is a great gaming experience, and I will definitely be playing the DLCs, cause damn it, I want more.
He dug behind something.
And for more red pill game reviews content, check out the blog, where I post gameplay reviews, production updates, and assorted commentary. You can find links to the entire RPGR multiverse at the top of my YouTube channel page. My name is Aincrow, and if I survive to make another episode, I will see you all in the next installment of Red Pill Game Reviews. Thank you for watching.
Get him off. He goes to the dead.